Europe's far north, a journey into Scandinavia's unending expanses, people and their stories. Lofoten is a rugged archipelago off the northwest coast of Norway. A man navigates a Maelstrom, the treacherous eddies that can drag ships into the deep. Skrova Fia. Despite satellite navigation, the most beautiful lighthouse of the Lofoten archipelago is still in use. On the hunt for the Northern Lights, she is researching the atmosphere in the Arctic with laser beams in Alomar Observatory. The Hurtig Line, replenishment for the people of the Arctic Ocean. Below decks, a comfortable journey to the end of the world. Arrivals here really are at the end of the world. All paths end at Moskenes. Anyone who wants to venture further into the Atlantic needs a boat or a plane. Moskenes is the furthest outpost of the Lofoten Islands. It is rarely so idyllic and still on this rugged archipelago as on this summer's day. A calm morning for the fishermen going out to sea. The area is known as one of the windiest and least hospitable regions north of the Arctic Circle, and as a paradise for whales. If you want to get from Moskenes to the open sea, you have no choice. You must cross the Maelstrom, one of the world's most dangerous currents. Nobody knows this better than Morten Nielsen. For years he's been navigating the Maelstrom with the Helvag, weather permitting.
Again and again we can't get out because it's too harsh in this area. Because of the weather, especially because of the swell and the current. Then we have huge waves here. Strong waves. Impassable waves.
It is particularly treacherous at full or new moon. Then eddies with a diameter of up to 10 meters and a depth of 8 meters develop. This is difficult to see from the surface.
The position between the high islands of Moskenes and Verøy makes it so dangerous. We steer over a hump that comes up from the bottom of the sea. Just here, the depth is 200 meters. And the same in the Vestfjord. And when the tide hits this hump, then we get these localized eddies. The whole ship can capsize.
Jules Verne recounted terrible things about the Maelstrom in his book 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, a whirlpool from which no vessel ever escapes, he wrote. And in Descent into the Maelstrom, Edgar Allan Poe wrote about a roaring mass of water wilder than the Niagara Falls. On the furthest headland, ruins remind us that the area used to be inhabited. The last settlers left the village of Hell more than 60 years ago. The houses were abandoned because they could only be reached via the Maelstrom, and the state subsidized the emigration. Morten Nielsen is not going fishing today. He has nostalgic reasons for returning to the southernmost tip of Lofoten.
I feel very connected to this place and feel real inner peace when I'm here. It's simply good to come here, to go on land here, to think about how it used to be. My family lived here for many generations. It is a really nice place.
In the end, only 50 people lived here, fishermen and farmers with their families.
Life was governed by hard work, by fishing and by nature, which was put to use in a variety of ways. They were people like all others. Some were good musicians. For example, my uncle was a great accordion and violin player. Many could draw and paint well. The people were as people are. Good fishermen and good housewives.
They moved into other Lofoten villages where it was safer and more comfortable. A little, anyway. To this day, everyday life on the Lofoten Islands is governed by the sea. If you live here, you need one thing in particular, a good boat. There is a kind of security center for shipping traffic in Kabelvag, north of the Maelstrom. Without the men from the Kystverket, shipping along the Norwegian coast would be perilous. Coastal wardens, such as Atle Rønning, are constantly on the move. They drive to maintenance works, see to broken shipping signs, repair cables and monitor the lighthouses. The fishermen in particular need this coastal administration.
As early as 1900, until around 1920, there were already around 10,000 fishermen in Lofoten. It's one of the richest cod fishing areas in the world.
Entry to Svolvær.
That's the fisherwoman. She greets everyone who arrives or departs.
Fish once made the region rich. And to this day, most islanders profit in some way from fishing, despite fishing quotas and overfishing. And when the fishermen go out into the Atlantic, while they may be under the protection of Fiskekone, the fisherwoman, when in doubt, they prefer to trust Atle Rønning.
I am a Norseman. You could say a fanatical Norseman. I burn for everything that happens here in northern Norway, so that we have a chance to continue living here.
Atle's favorite journey is across to Skorova Fyr, a lighthouse like in a picture book. On a clear day, the light of Skrova Fyr can be seen for nearly 40 kilometers. On a bad day, the beam doesn't even reach the mainland. With Atle in the dinghy is Kjell Einar. The tower has sent an error message to the station. The tour is a welcome excuse to leave the office.
We're always about outside doing reconnaissance. We enjoy that, even if we don't meet anybody on the way. Everybody knows everybody here, because we live in a very tight-knit community.
It was a difficult decision to make Skrovafyr automatic and replace the keepers with computers. But the costs of a permanent keeper finally just got too high. The last keeper left in the summer of 2005. Now the mobile team takes care of the operation.
We take photos and gather information about the instruments. The pictures are a kind of notebook that we evaluate later. You can explain that better.
When we arrived, there was a kind of alarm. Here at central control, where we can operate the lighthouse manually, now we have to climb up the tower and put the light on.
In the old days, one of the lighthouse keepers would have just done that. Skrovafyr is more than just a piece of picturesque coastal decoration. To this day, the lighthouse cannot be replaced by satellite navigation, assuming the reflectors are clean.
GPS is only an aid and can't be compared to a lighthouse. The young people are used to sorting everything via their monitors, but switch the thing off and watch them navigate via the beacon, then they have a problem. They haven't learned how to do that. On the day their GPS fails, they'll be drifting around helplessly out here.
In the old days, it was always two men on duty on Skrova, a keeper and his assistant. They had to share the living quarters for weeks. They still emanate a trace of coziness.
I think things worked a lot better when the lighthouse was manned. The houses were in good condition. In just 2 years, that changed completely. The colors alone. It used to be all freshly painted. It was a pearl out here.
These wouldn't have been here with the lighthouse keepers. Weeds. The kitchen was left behind in full working order in case someone wanted to move in again. Atle and Kjell are happy about this. At the moment, anyway. Hygiene is becoming a bit of an issue. On Skrova, there used to be an unwritten law. The cook is always right. The others had to eat what is put on the table, without complaint.
If you can imagine two men under one roof for a month without being able to go home to the wife, no surprise that they turned into an old married couple without being married.
To endure the daily grind also means surviving the long, cold, dark winter of the north. No matter how bad the weather, the ships of the legendary Hurtig Line nearly always sail. June Larsen can no longer count how often she has sailed up and down the Norwegian coast.
And that's two different journeys. Oh yeah, you can leave the ship again. Yes. Thank you.
Formerly known as the purser, June is the officer with the job of looking after the passengers.
Hele min familie er maritim.
We're all sailors in my family. My father is a captain, my stepfather a pilot,
My mother worked on the Hurtigruten. My uncle is a captain, my nephew a machine operator. It's completely normal for us to work on a ship. We know our way around.
June's floating workplace is constantly en route between Kirkenes and Bergen. What started off as a rustic post line has over the last 100 years developed into a ferry, freight and cruise line in one. A trip on the Hurtigruten is one of the most beautiful voyages in the world. It is nearly 3,000 kilometers from Kirkenes to Bergen. June's colleagues are a bit like a second family for her, maybe even her first. She started work on the legendary post route as a general dog's body. She loves her job and is in two minds whether she should accept a job offer as project manager in the company. Without a crew. And on land.
I haven't worked on land for 12 years, so that'll be exciting. I'm used to spending 3 weeks on board and 3 weeks at home. My two families, the one at home and the one on the ship. When I get up, I only have to walk up two stairways to get to work. Let's see what this job working from 8 to 4 on land will be like.
MS Trollfjord is one of 11 ships constantly plying to and fro on the Hurtigruten, the Norwegian coastal express. They run a shuttle service up the rugged coast on an 11-day trip between the Russian border and southern Norway. It is good manners at sea to greet sister ships properly. June knows every move on the Trollfjord. Nearly every. She's never driven a forklift truck, even though motors and machines are her passion. The hold is nearly empty on this winter's journey.
We also transport freight from place to place. For a few months in northern Norway, we are the only link to the outside world in bad weather. We bring them food, we transport lemonade, crates. We have room for 45 cars on board. And four large cargo holds.
It used to be freight ships that took passengers. Today it's passenger ships that take freight. There are 67 stops on each round trip. ...67 opportunities for a short trip ashore. If you aren't back on time, then that's tough luck. June meets the captain at least once a day or night. For a briefing, so the boss knows what's happening on his ship.
Men det går ju an att göra på en manuell måte här uppe, för det är inte så mycket folk som snackar.
Nej,
Even though Hurtigrut means hasty line, life on board is rarely hasty. Really, it should be called leisure line. June is happy on board. Most of the time, anyway.
Sometimes it's difficult. If something terrible happens with a family, a death, for example, and you're on board and can't leave the ship. In the worst case, you have to wait 1 or 2 days until you can get home.
There is one hectic place on board, the galley. Food for 800 passengers has to be ready on time. To the galley crew's great delight, the restaurant guests all want the same thing today. Too many special requests plunge the galley into chaos. Just like a century ago, the crew on the Hurtigrut ships are almost entirely Norwegian. And the ships sail under the Norwegian flag to this day. June Larsen's working day ends just before midnight, whilst the Trollfjord is entering the port of Tromsø.
Normally, I spend 183 days a year on board, but last year it was 225. My youngest niece had difficulty recognizing me at first. When she got a bit older, she always knew immediately who Aunt June is, and my friends have got used to it. I just have to call them and tell them I'm back.
Not every island is visited by the Hurtigrut. Andøya is omitted, even though it's the 10th largest island in Norway. Maybe it lies too far out into the Atlantic. Maybe too few people live here. Even though Andøya is world famous, to climate researchers anyway, one of Europe's most important observatories is here. The Alomar Observatory. Sandra Blindheim is the director and is responsible for the large laser on the top of the mountain. It is clearly no coincidence that there's an observatory here.
Andøya is situated at a latitude within the Northern Lights Oval, an area where you can see the aurora borealis particularly well. And we can see exciting things. In addition to the northern lights, we can see noctilucent clouds that glow at night. We're at the edge of the Arctic here, the green Arctic, so to speak.
And what's the whole thing for? The laser beam that Sandra and her team point into the sky delivers important information about the atmosphere, our climate, about ozone holes. The data are used by scientists around the world.
On this bench, we produce the special light and the color that we need. It looks chaotic, but it's set up systematically so we can direct the laser beam into the atmosphere.
Laserstrålen ut I atmosfären, så den startar där borta.
It starts at the front there, then through here, along here, through this box, here, along the other side of the table, and then through the hole in the wall out into the atmosphere.
Measurements are best done at night without distracting daylight.
When we send laser beams into the atmosphere, they hit air molecules and airborne particles that reflect light. We measure the light that comes back to us in our mirror. Here in the observatory, we deliver the building blocks with which scientists can research atmospheric change.
Place of work, Andøya. Sandra Blindheim originally comes from southern Norway and took a long time to get used to living without urban comforts. After a few years in northern Norway, she still considers her move a good thing.
It's hard to find such a great place. I'm very glad that so much is happening around me. All these colors. For someone who loves nature, it's the perfect place.
The Red Lighthouse is Andenes' landmark, the only sizable settlement on the island. Most people live from fishing and tourism. Or as scientists. Sandra's observatory belongs to the Andøya rocket range, a missile testing and launching area.
It really is a special place of work, because we sit on top of a mountain. We're up here because we need to be far from other light sources for our work. The distance from the sea is important too, because the salt air would damage our lenses and lasers.
When a clear winter's night settles over Sandra's observatory, this is not only good for the measurements. One has a panoramic view of the northern lights from the roof. But be careful when the laser is on.
When we stand on the roof of the observatory, we have to wear glasses to protect our eyes from the laser beam. Every pulse we send into the atmosphere is 150 million watts. The safety distance to our laser is 350 kilometers. There are rumors that there are many blind gulls and eagles around the observatory, but I don't know if that's true.
Many villages in the thinly populated north have become holiday home estates. If you live here and want to go shopping, you need to drive to the nearest town. Unless you have someone like Anna Zandt in your neighborhood. She's shoveling the entrance to her corner shop, as on every winter's day. Sometimes there are even customers, but the shop is never full.
Yeah.
Anna's shop is one of the few independent shops in Norway that serve the needs of the rural population. It sells basic goods, those that you need to survive. And it is a place to meet.
It's mainly a social meeting point for such a small place as this. There are no businesses here anymore. They've all gone, and in this way a settlement dies. It's my aim to keep this village alive.
Of course, Anna knows all her customers, and they all know her. As the owner of a small shop, Anna has little leverage when it comes to buying.
I have a feeling nobody thinks about this. People only see that we're more expensive. Maybe they think I'm lining my own pockets. I should make them aware that it's simply more expensive to go shopping in a small shop.
The small settlement on the outer edge of Lofoten is called Festresand. It used to be a fishing village. Anna is disappointed that there is so little state help for the upkeep of the village.
Norway is a rich country if we think of things like nature and all the positive things. We live a good life. But at the same time, we're a bit irritated here at the edge of Lofoten that there's no money for the upkeep of the school or the nursery. Or the old people's home and such like. We have to take our children away from here so that they can go to school.
Luckily, Anna doesn't have to live off her small shop alone. She has another job as an accountant. She has modest plans for her shop. She wants it to become even more comfortable. Not much needs changing in the line of goods. Over the decades, this has been perfectly adapted to the needs of the villagers. Anna didn't open the shop herself. She comes from a long line of grocers of Vestresand. The first shop is still standing on the other side of the road along the water's edge. The wooden house has long stood empty. Maybe Anna will convert the hut to holiday accommodation. That would bring more life to the village, should anyone come. It's the women who decide the course of action. Three generations now work in the shop. At some point, Anna will pass on the business to her daughter Asti. Whatever the future may bring, one thing is clear.
I don't want to have a supermarket, no. I want a small, cozy shop. The customers should be more than a number in a queue. They should feel welcome here, talk to each other and be sociable. I'm planning a small cafe. I hope to get that done next spring.
When temperatures stay reliably below zero and a bitter wind blows from the west and the central Europeans prefer to stay indoors, that's when the Lofoten fishing season begins. Nets are being repaired everywhere in the harbour. The biggest schools of cod pass the coast from January to April. The fishermen earn most of their income at this time of year. Including Morten Nielsen. The Maelstrom man from Moskenes has caught the fishing frenzy. Unfortunately, Morten has an engine defect. He bought a bigger ship. The Helsega has to be paid off and has broken down now of all times.
This is a windlass, which we need to wind the ropes in. We've put 12 systems out into the Atlantic on the western side of Moskenes. That's 6 kilometers of catching rope altogether. 3,600 hooks hang from them.
The yard's workers have been trying for hours to get their tub ship shape again. Something is wrong with the oil. Morten has already tried to find the fault himself, but without success. The Helsega was bought second-hand. This probably wouldn't have happened with a new boat.
Of course, that is a disadvantage. But if you have a ship like this built new, then that costs 12 to 15 million crowns, 1.5 to 2 million euros. I bought mine second-hand for a tenth of that price, and I can transfer my old fishing quota to this ship.
Morten has not given up hope of getting in his lines and bringing the catch home, just like his colleagues. You can see that fish plays a central role all over the Lofoten Islands now. Dried cod hangs in the drying racks. Tied together at the tail, the cod is made durable in a simple way. But not Morten's fish. Morten is sitting below deck. Together with the previous owner of the ship. The two of them are not looking for faults. The boys in the yard are doing that. Old charts are being poured over. The old man is known as one of the best fishermen in Norway and enjoys giving the younger generation his advice. Things are looking up for Morten's colleagues. They're returning from the Atlantic with full ships. The cod cleaners are very busy in the coming cold weeks. The crates contain skrei, migrant cod from the Arctic. Whilst most cod populations are depleted as a result of overfishing, the situation is better with skrei, thanks to strict controls. The fish probably wouldn't see it this way. Fishing is and will always be a hard business.
The fish population is increasing. There are good prognoses for cod, Atlantic salmon and haddock. And it looks like we can increase our quotas. We are hoping for a chance to get better quotas for individual boats.
And when the Helsaga can go to sea again, Morten Nielsen's world will be back in order, no matter how cold it gets outside.
I could do a different job and be more comfortable. It can be hard, very hard. But for me, it's even harder sitting twiddling my thumbs with a ship in the harbor than it is being out at sea. This is my lifestyle, a vocation, and a way of life, quite simply.